Singing to a God who's revealed himself to us so that we can know that there's no one like him. The reason we know that is because he's shown himself to us in his word and in what he's done in our lives, and that is exciting. That's worth praising God for. Well, welcome here to Gateway Church for all of those who are here in person, and welcome here for those who are watching online. We especially want to welcome you, whether you're online or here in person. If you're here for the very first time, welcome here. We've got some guests here this morning because it's a special Sunday. It's one of our spiritual milestones that we celebrate from time to time, the preteen passage. Many of our young people graduating from basically preteen years to teen years. And so that's pretty exciting, and they've invited family members to celebrate that time with them. So welcome here, those of you who are here as guests for that. And if you have any questions or want to just contact us for any reason, as a person who's a part of Gateway or new to Gateway, there's a button on our website that says contact us, and you can click on that and ask anything you'd like. We also have something pretty special coming up this morning. I'm going to be inviting someone up to the front as part of the message this morning, who's going to be sharing some pretty amazing things going on in his life. So be anticipating that. And let's just ask the Lord to help us this morning. Father, thank you. You have revealed yourself to us as a God like no one else, nothing else. There's no other God that can compare to you. You are greater than, infinitely greater than anything else in this world or universe. And so we worship you this morning, and I pray you'd fill our hearts with praise as you reveal yourself to us in our time of worship here this morning. In Jesus' name, amen.
Healing glory. Now Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, we call these bones to live, call these lungs to sing.
One of the ways we express our worship is through these songs that have been written that focus on the name of Jesus, that focus on this God who is like no other. But we also express worship through giving. We express worship through our offerings. And so as we express our trust in God and our faith in God through giving, let it be worship for any of you who participate and for any of you who are online who are participating. The way you can participate are all listed on our website. If you go to the top right corner of our homepage, gatewaywinnipeg.com, there's a give, the word give. You click on that, it'll give you all kinds of instructions or guidance as to how you can give. If you want to express your worship in that way. And we thank all of you as who are part of Gateway Church who have been expressing your worship that way, because God has been so faithful to us in providing for us. Amen. I want to invite Ron up to bring a few announcements.
Thanks, Ken. Good morning, everybody. Good morning, Gateway Church, and good morning to all our guests who are here. Thank you so much for joining us in person and online. I just have three short announcements, and the third one is the best one, so wait for that one. The first one is Gateway East. As some of you may know, well, hopefully a lot of you know, some of you may not know, but we'll be leaving this location. We're planting two new congregations, one in this area and one across the river in West St. Paul. And of course, we have a congregation in the south of the city. And so the Gateway East congregation is going to be staying here. We'll be launching their congregation in June. You can sign up for small groups. It's really an exciting way to launch and plant church because we're going to do it through small groups. And we're really excited about that. You can check your Gateway Weekly News email for any more information. Gateway North, which will be moving across the river to West St. Paul, in our new facility, we won't be in our new facility until September, so we're going to be meeting in the Sonova Center, which is the recreation center in West St. Paul, beginning in June at 11 a.m. We're going to have our services there, 11 a.m. Note the time change, not 10, but 11 a.m. And bring a picnic, because there's a great park right there, and we're going to be able to have picnics and have great time of connecting with one another. You can always see your Gateway Weekly News mail for that as well. And finally, this is the best announcement. Our last Sunday in this facility after 34 years will be May 29th. Now, we built this facility with our own hands. I remember 1988, we built the first building. 1995, we built this. Some of you were up in the rafters. A lot of the church built it. So we've had a wonderful time here for 34 years. We want to celebrate God's faithfulness and goodness to us in 34 years. We want to go out with joy, and we want to go into the new place with joy. So we're going to have a great celebration on May 29th. My wife Mary is going to lead the worship. We're going to do a medley of songs from the 80s, 90s, 2000s, 2010. Going to be really great. And John Micklefield, who was one of the first pastors on staff with me, is going to be preaching the message. We're going to have testimonies from people. We're going to have balloons and ice cream. It's going to be a lot of fun. And we're going to have a slideshow of 34 years. So if you have any slides that are you think would be great for this slideshow, go to our website, gatewaywinnipeg.com. You can click on the PANET through the decades. There'll be a button there, and you can upload your photo. So we're looking forward to May 29th. Thanks so much, Ken.
Thank you, Ron. Great. I'd like to invite the 10 preteens and their parents to come up and just line up here. In fact, if you can line up so that you're kind of, some of you are up on this substage with me, if we can kind of meet in the middle here, that would be great. Our sound man, Randy Braun, is bringing the mics. Is this cool? Like, let's give Randy a round of applause. What would we do without you, Randy? Yeah, Randy, I said, what would we do without him? He says, you'd yell. All right. Well, welcome to our celebration of the preteen passage milestone. Today we're celebrating with the grade sixes of Gateway Church as they graduate from Gateway Kids and become a part of Gateway Youth. Some of them have been waiting and eagerly waiting for this for quite some time. This is a significant transition because preteens are leaving their childhood years and they're heading into adolescence. Does anybody remember adolescence who's already experienced it? So we see this as a key opportunity for them to renew their commitment to follow Jesus wholeheartedly. Amen? A key verse that the parents and the preteens discussed in their preparation class for this very event was Ephesians 2, verse 10. And I want to remind the preteens of that passage that speaks of the truth of who you are in Christ. For you are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that you should walk in them. Leading up to today, these parents have prayerfully chosen a passage of Scripture to share with their preteens as a special blessing on their graduation into their teen years. They are now going to introduce themselves to us, and then they're going to speak a blessing over their preteen. So we're going to start with Serge and his family, and then left, right, left, right.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Serge. It's my lovely wife, Nicolette. Our son, Brady, and our daughter, Eliora. Today, we have two verses to bless Brady as he's moving forward to the high school. The first one is Joshua 1:9. Brady, be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid or discouraged, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. The second one is Proverbs 3:5-6. Brady, trust in the Lord with all your heart. Do not depend on your own understanding. Seek his will in all you do, and he will show you which path to take. Amen. Amen.
Good morning. I'm Chris, my wife Meg, and this is Emmy, short for Emmanuel. And we've got two verses for you, Emmy. The first one is from Philippians 1:9, says this: I pray that your love will overflow more and more, and that you'll keep on growing in knowledge and understanding. And the second from Numbers 6:24-26. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace.
Hi, I'm Irene Ansaka, and this is Enzo Kashinda. The verse I have choose for you, Enzo, is Proverbs 3:5-6. Trust in the Lord with all your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. In all your ways, acknowledge him, and he will make straight your paths. Here is Hezibah Kagea Obewa. The verse that we chose for her is from Isaiah chapter 62, verse 3 to 4, and that's where her name comes from. You shall also be a crown of glory in the hand of your God, and a royal diadem in the hand of your God, and you shall be called Hezibah, and your land Beulah, for the Lord delights in you, and your land shall be married. And I pray that God shall bless you abundantly. Amen.
Hello, I'm Dawson Craker. This is my wife, Jenny, and this is our son, Isaac. And we have a few verses for you this morning for Isaac.
So we've always prayed that Isaac would be a worshiper and have a heart of worship. And so one of our verses we pray over him is that he would come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods.
And Isaiah 61 says, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me, because the Lord has anointed me to bring good news to the poor, to grant to those who mourn in Zion, to give them a beautiful headdress instead of ashes, that they may be called oaks of righteousness, the planting of the Lord, that he may be glorified. And that's our prayer for Isaac, that he would be an oak of righteousness, the planting of the Lord.
Morning, I'm David, and this is my wife Kate, and this is Lincoln. And so we chose Micah 6:8. He has shown you, O mortal, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God.
Praise the Lord. My name is Philip Tolula Day, and this is Jomiloju. Today we are speaking a blessing over Jomiloju. from Isaiah 54, 13 and 14, Oluwa Jomiloju shall be taught of the law, and great shall be the peace of Oluwa Jomiloju. In righteousness you shall be established. You shall be far from oppression, for you shall not fear, and from terror, for it shall not come near you. The second scripture is from Matthew 5:14. Oluwa Jomiloju, you are the light of the world, and you are a city set upon a hill that cannot be hidden.
Good morning. This is Nico Friesen and his parents, Bernie and Jody.
And Nico, the blessing we chose for you is from 1 Corinthians 16, 13 and 14. Remember to stay alert and hold firmly to all that you believe. Be mighty and full of courage. Let love and kindness be the motivation behind all that you do.
Good morning. My name is Peculia. Here's my husband, Anthony, and our first fruits, Zariah. Zariah means a new rising with Christ. And his middle name means Tegese, means the time of God has come.
And we are declaring this scripture on Zariah. Arise, shine, for your light has come, and the glory of the Lord rises upon you. Nations will come to your light, and kings to the brightness of your dawn. That's from Isaiah 60, verse 1 and 3. And from Deuteronomy 33, verse 24. About Zariah, he said, most blessed son is Zariah. Let him be favored by his brothers, and let him bathe his feet in oil. Amen.
Okay, I'm going to invite all of you to line up across the front here, you know, just sort of meet in the middle and create a bit of an arc here in front of all the chairs. And if you could face me, because this is a significant time in the preteens' lives and in their journeys with God, we want to give them and their parents an opportunity to recommit themselves to pursuing God in this next season of their lives. So this first faith commitment that we're going to invite you to make is to both the preteens and to the parents. So with the help of the Holy Spirit, will you commit today to love the Lord with all your heart, soul, and strength by living according to His Word? Okay, now we have a commitment that we're going to ask directly to the parents. Do you accept? Oh, here we go. Come on up. Come on up, Helen. Helen and Ed had car trouble today, as if the enemy wanted to interfere with this significant moment in their son's life. So here they are. They made it. So if you want to read the blessing over, and that, feel free to step up to the mic there.
Okay. Luanda, my son, fear not, for I am with you, thus says the Lord. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you. I will help you. I will uphold you with my victorious right hand.
Yes. Amen. Amen. That's beautiful. The Lord has upheld them this morning and brought them on time. I'm going to redo, if you're okay with it, preteens and parents, to the first commitment, so that Helen and her son can participate in that. Is that okay? Good. With the help of the Holy Spirit, will you commit today to love the Lord with all your heart, soul, and strength by living according to His will? Amen. Hello, Ed. Parents, including Ed and Helen, do you accept God's call to be your preteen's primary faith influencer and commit to impart the truth of God's word and the love of God to your preteen as you live life together?
I do.
Okay, preteens, here is your opportunity to make a commitment to follow Jesus as you head into your teen years. With the help of the Holy Spirit, do you commit to pursue a relationship with God characterized by choosing His ways over any other? You want to say that more clearly with emphasis? Amen. Good. All right. As a church body, we know that we live, it's like we're a village together, and we all participate together in supporting each other as families. So if you would like to participate in this precious milestone, I just invite you to stand. And I'm going to invite all of you families who are here to turn and face the congregation. Congregation, will you partner with these parents by supporting and encouraging them as they raise their children in the ways of the Lord?
We will.
Amen. All right. Parents, you could turn back this way. I'm going to invite you to lay hands on your kids, and we're going to pray. I'm going to just pray a blessing over them, and you can participate in that. If in the congregation, if you want to participate in this, feel free to extend your hands as an expression of that participation. Father, I thank you so much for how you have watched over these families till this point. Lord, they've reached this precious milestone by your grace and with your help. And Lord, you're going to continue to help them. You're going to help them through these teen years. And we pray, Lord, your spirit would be upon these parents and upon these preteens as they enter these teen years. And you would help them, Lord, to be warriors in this world full of resistance to your ways, but you'd also help them to be ministers of your peace and grace to people around them in this world. Lord, you'd help them to be lights in the worlds they walk and live in as teenagers. And I pray, Lord, that they would be an aroma of Christ to their friends around them, and they would draw people to you. Lord, we've already spoken that you have purposes over their lives. You prepared them for good works. Prepared good works beforehand that they should walk in them, and I pray that you'd give them the grace to walk in every good work that you've prepared for them to walk in. And Lord, that as your purposes are accomplished in their lives, you would be glorified in these families. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 Bless you guys. I want to invite Terry Dirksen to come on up. Let's welcome Terry this morning. Well, Terry, it's great to have you sharing with us here this morning.
Well, thank you.
And those are very, very cool clothes you're wearing there. I got to get me some of those. Those look like Métis clothes, is that right?
That's correct. I'm not Métis. I'm shockingly a Dirksen, and but I've had a few Métis friends who have tried to get me to dress up in a way that's similar to a Red River cart driver from a previous century. And next time you go down Lage, I don't know if there's going to be a picture up there.
But yeah, there will be.
Next time you go down Lage, look at the sign. There's a guy on the sign, and he's kind of dressed like me.
Let's put that picture up. There we go. That's Anyways, Terry. That's picture yeah. of Terry Dirksen.
Well, not exactly. That's Jean-Baptiste Lagemodier, and he was maybe the most famous of the Red River cart drivers. So.
Okay. I did not know that, actually. I mean, I knew it was Lagemodier, but I didn't know he was the most famous of those Oxcart drivers. And I guess you're wearing those clothes because you're planning to go on an Oxcart journey, aren't you? Do you want to tell us a little bit about what you're planning?
Yeah, so 200 years ago, the easiest way to get to the outside world from this place was this torturous trip by either York boat or canoe up to Hudson Bay. And you might have to stay there over winter and then catch a sailing across the Atlantic, which was another long trip. But the Red River Trail changed all that. So the Red River Trail made its way from what was then Red River, now Winnipeg, all the way down to the Mississippi. And so both cities at both ends grew up as a result of the trail. Winnipeg at this end and St. Paul at the other end. And so starting Tuesday, my wife Patty and I and our ox Zeke want to retrace the 500 miles or so down to St. Paul, Minnesota. And actually, the original cart box, the suitcase that was used by Jean-Baptiste Lajumodier, we're going to carry on the back of our cart for a little ways down the trail.
Oh, that is so cool. That's a piece of history.
Yeah.
That just sounds incredibly epic and amazing. And in fact, it occurs to me to say it sounds unheard of for someone to do such a thing. But actually, it's not unheard of. It's been done so many times that it created these two cities. These two cities grew out of that trail being used by Oxcart drivers. You're going to be retracing their steps. But I expect this is kind of unheard of for the average person that's sitting here. They've probably never imagined doing such a thing. And did you just kind of wake up one morning and think, you know what, I ought to take an ox cart trip from Winnipeg to St. Paul?
How did you know? Well, it actually began in the prayer furnace, where many of you have spent hours. Used to be a little building on our property here. And I felt the Lord asking me to start focusing on praying for Winnipeg. So a few weeks into that, I started wondering, why am I sitting inside when I could be walking around Winnipeg? And then I thought, well, why don't I literally walk around Winnipeg? So that's what I did. I started on the north perimeter, and that got pretty noisy and pretty busy pretty fast. So I decided to walk around the city boundaries itself. So the city boundary, sometimes it follows a gravel road, sometimes it follows a dirt road, or maybe it just cuts across a farmer's field. So what I did is if I came to a creek or to a swamp, I would just wade through it. And if I came to a river, I'd swim across it.
Oh.
Often other people would join me. And it was an adventure, but it was more than that, much more than that. It was a symbol of claiming land for the glory of the Creator.
Amen.
I felt God's presence and His power and His direction. Wonderful. In my prayer. I shared His love and His concern for the city. And I felt things shifting and unlocking. So when I reached the end of my lap around town, I kept going. I canoed the rivers and snowshoed the creeks and skied the trails and biked the paths. And somewhere along the way, I gained this metaphor from the Canadian Rangers. The Rangers are a group of quasi-military, mostly indigenous people who live on the frontiers of this nation. They're the official presence of Canada in these unpeopled spaces. They call their trips out on the land sovereignty patrols, or SOVPATs for short, because they're declaring that the places they pass through are sovereign territory. So I realized I was doing the same thing for Winnipeg, but on a spiritual level. With my presence and words, I was declaring that Creator God is the sovereign Lord of this city.
Amen.
So I and anyone who went with me started calling these ventures SOVPATs. I often wished I could do something like this on a bigger scale, a SOVPAT on a bigger scale. And because I love history, maybe something like a Red River cart trip.
Wow, so that's how you woke up one morning thinking about doing an ox cart ride. That's an amazing way to pray for the city of Winnipeg, Terry. Like, I suspect no one's ever done that before, crossing swamps and rivers. But
well, I don't know. I didn't meet anybody else doing the same thing. So.
Let's look at some pictures we've got of people who have joined you on that. Well, there's Terry and his wife, Patty, and that's the ox cart. That's Zeke. Say hi to Zeke. Okay, wow. Do you see what we have back
there?
Yeah,
I'm walking on the back one, yeah.
Yeah, that's Terry and his sister, who is with the Lord right now. Your son.
That's Leaf and Leaf. I swamping it.
He's going through a swamp. Is he in water right now?
Yep.
He's in water, going through a swamp. Okay. Oh, there's the snowshoes. So you're snowshoeing, you're swamp.
You see the little water pattern on the top?
Yeah.
Lord. They're crosses. Do you see that?
That's true. That's riding your bikes in the winter. That's your son.
Yeah, that's him. Yeah.
Okay.
Oh, that's wow. Him again. He got a new hat for the occasion.
Simeon joined him in winter and summer, and I think that's what we've got so far. So this trip from Winnipeg to St. Paul, using the route that led to the creation of the city of Winnipeg and the creation of the city of St. Paul, using the mode of transport that they used back then, is basically like an epic soft path, right? Yeah. So we're entitling this sharing time together an epic soft path, if you will. Is Patty as excited about this idea as you are, Terry?
Well, she's wearing Métis clothes.
Where are you, Patty? Why don't you stand up, Patty?
There was actually one big obstacle that would never allow Epic Sov Pat to happen. I wouldn't go without Patty. And I knew that if she heard of the idea, she would think it was crazy. So I realized that it would remain only a dream. But somewhere along the Lord kept on nudging me further along this road. And finally, I worked up the courage to talk to Patty about it. I predicted her response. She laughed out loud.
Out loud.
Yeah. But before she could say, no way, I jumped in and said, whoa, I just want you to go to the Lord with it and ask him of his opinion. And if he confirms it, great. I wasn't about to convince Patty to go along with me because I figured 3 days down the trail and the mosquitoes are biting and the rain is pouring. I don't want to be the one to take the blame at that point. So
the Lord will take the blame.
So it had to be the Lord calling her or we weren't going. Patty works as a companion for elderly people. A few weeks after our talk, she was with Frida Esselmont, and some of you know her son, Barry, who used to go to the church here. Frida was a proper English lady. And her response to anything outside of her sphere of propriety was, that's terrible. And so, for example, Patty said, I'm the youngest of 12 children. That's awful. So Patty felt pretty safe in telling Frida her wacky idea, or the wacky idea of her husband, right? This Oxcart journey. And Frida's response, well, I think that's marvelous.
Wow.
What are you going to do? Sit on a couch the rest of your life?
She said that. Wow.
So an answer that bizarre struck Patty as the word of the Lord. And God has confirmed that calling on her 100 times since then.
Wow. So Patty's going in faith. You know, Terry, this obviously seems to have a lot to do with expressing the heart of God for the city of Winnipeg. And this fits well with how God expresses himself in the Bible. We recently finished that sermon series on the prophet Jonah, which is about God calling one of his prophets to go preach to a city of people who weren't following the Lord. And I'm wondering, do you identify at all with that story in the sense of feeling sent by God somehow?
I'd like to back up a step. God has been at work in this place a long time.
Yeah.
There's an oral history among both the Cree and the Anishinaabe, and it's actually backed up by archaeological evidence of a great work of God, or Gitche Manitou, as they refer to him, that happened 700 years ago. And as a result of that, there was 500 years of peace between the tribes.
Wow.
Till this day, people have been praying and interceding to God to continue to work in the city. So I'm in awe of many of you, and I feel like I'm standing on giant shoulders when I'm doing this. I'm not an amazing prayer. I'm willing to tramp around in God's presence. And my prayer muscles have been growing. One skill God is helping me learn is to stay focused while, say, zipping along at 30 kilometers an hour on a electric kick scooter, or maybe while driving a reluctant ox. So yes, I feel God has sent me, because he's giving me what I need to do this stuff.
Right.
When I first started planning this epic SovPat, I hoped God would show up. The more I've seen his hand setting up every detail, the more I realize it's been his idea all along. God loves Winnipeg. He'll do anything he can to express that love. A car trip looks a lot different than what Jonah was asked to do. But I can see God's love for Winnipeg has the same kind of intensity as his love for Nineveh.
Amen. Amen. And you sent me a few scripture references that highlight how great this need is for SovPats, like the ones you've already done around the city of Winnipeg, and that highlight actually the resistance that there is to such an activity. Psalm 55, 9 to 11 says, I see violence and strife in the city. Day and night they go around it on its walls, and iniquity and trouble are within it. Ruin is in its midst. Oppression and fraud do not depart from its marketplace. That sounds like a place that needs prayer. Psalm 59 says, each evening they come back howling like dogs, prowling about the city. They wander about for food and growl if they do not get their fill. But I will sing of your strength. I will sing aloud of your steadfast love in the morning, for you have been to me a fortress and a refuge in the day of my distress. Well, that's a great response to the resistance, isn't it?
You know, Winnipeg used to be known as the murder capital of Canada.
Yep.
And more recently, the most racist city in Canada. Those are pretty painful titles for anyone who loves their city.
Yeah.
And I know that God hurt the same way, you know, for his beloved city of Winnipeg. While I was walking along the city boundaries, the most common theme that came to mind as I prayed, especially along the southern edge, was keeping evil at bay. I felt my role in that case was like a watchman.
Yeah. Yeah. In fact, that fits with how God speaks in his word about how he set a watchman over a very special city in Scripture, the city of Jerusalem. The prophet Isaiah wrote this, on your walls, O Jerusalem, I have set watchmen. All the day and all the night they shall never be silent. You who put the Lord in remembrance, take no rest and give him no rest until he establishes Jerusalem and makes it a praise in the earth. This is God choosing the city of Jerusalem as the place to establish his name in the earth. As a city, it represents God's dwelling place. His dwelling place for his name, and was also a symbol of the future city of God, where God promises to dwell with his people forever. Now, I'm not sure how many people have wondered this, but I've wondered why God would choose a city to represent his dwelling place. Cities, to me, feel hectic and busy and often crime-filled. Why wouldn't God choose a more peaceful place, like a green pasture that we see in Psalm 23 as representing his dwelling place that he'll establish his place with us in one day? And I think maybe it's because cities are where people dwell. It's where people gather. It's where people gather in great numbers. And God loves people. So where people are gathering, you can find God's love. And even when cities turn to evil, God doesn't reject those people, but he calls his people to pray for them. And he calls people to go and tell them about his love, which really reflects what these SovPats represent.
Yeah, in a verse that you previously quoted, I found it interesting the strategy the psalmist has to fight evil in the city. He sang. He sang of God's love.
Yeah.
If you're like me, you might think the evil in Winnipeg is too big. I can't fight it.
Yeah.
But I can sing. That's easy.
Yeah. Yeah.
So if you ever see a guy in the middle of a swamp singing to nobody in particular about the love of God, you'll know what he's up to.
You'll know what he's up to. And you're all welcome to give that a try. Because God wants us to be, God loves cities because that's where people are, and he wants us to be praying for the people of those cities and the people of our city that he's placed us in. And speaking of singing, the Psalms are songs. Psalm 48, for example, is a song about the city of Jerusalem, which the songwriter calls the city of our God. It says there, "Great is the Lord and greatly to be praised in the city of our God. His holy mountain, beautiful in elevation, is the joy of all the earth. Mount Zion in the far north, the city of the great king." But then what comes up later in that psalm is the psalmist sings, "We have thought on your steadfast love, O God, in the midst of your temple. As your name, O God, so your praise reaches to the ends of the earth. Your right hand is filled with righteousness. Let Mount Zion be glad. Let the daughters of Judah rejoice because of your judgments." He's singing about God's steadfast love.
I actually have a story that kind of illustrates that pretty fun in a fun way. When I'm driving out to do a soft pat, I usually spend that time waiting on the Lord and asking him for direction, and then whatever clues he gives me, I'll go with that. So, for example, one time I saw the street name Bowman as I was driving, and Patty and I were going out to do a canoeing soft pat, and so I thought, okay, I would pray for Mayor Bowman. And so as we were canoeing, whenever I'd lose focus, I'd see Patty up ahead of me, my own in the bow of the canoe.
Do you have that picture? There we go. That's a saw of Pat with Patty at the bow of the canoe.
So my own personal bowman at the bow of the canoe kept me focused on praying on track, right? So, but that actually the story I was going to tell happened when I was on my bike, and As I waited on the Lord ahead of time, I felt God saying, "Pray that people will worship me loudly." So that's kind of weird, but I've learned to go with the light that I've been given.
Yep.
So I started praying along those lines. As I biked along, I suddenly started noticing that there was a worship song coming from somewhere. So that was a little bit curious. So I started following some side streets. And as I went, it got louder and louder until finally I came to the house. And on the picnic table in front of the house was a ghetto blaster cranked right up with the song I'd been hearing at full volume. Behind, I forget what the song is now, but behind the table there was what looked like a hippie from the 60s, but now grown old with long gray hair. And she was bopping along. And I tried to tell her how cool it was, how I loved what she was doing. And either the music was so loud or she was deaf and couldn't hear me. So finally, I just gave her two thumbs up and went back on my bike on the road.
That's fantastic. Yeah. I wonder who that was. You know, because you're following the edge of the city as you're doing those soft pats, it sounds like that lady's praise was reaching the ends of the city, as he speaks of reaching the ends of the earth in the psalm. And the songwriter of Psalm 48 goes on to say, very similar to what you were doing, Terry, walk about Zion, go around her. I think God was thinking of you when he inspired that psalm. Number her towers, consider well her ramparts, go through her citadels that you may tell the next generation that this is God, our God forever and ever. And you had the next generation in your family participating with you in this. He will guide us forever, Psalm 48.
And the previous generation. I've also done soft paths with my mom.
That's beautiful. Where was that? Which part of the city was that?
Well, we didn't actually. We were overlooking the city on a place called Moose Nose Hill. Yep. And we built a fire together, and we're just praying over the city.
That's really sweet to imagine Mary there with you. That's fantastic. You've been doing this thing, walking around Winnipeg, praying for the city of Winnipeg, but now you're doing something different. You're going on an Oxcart ride away from Winnipeg. That's different. What, are you sure you're going in the right direction?
Yeah, well, honestly, I've wondered the same. And I'm the kind of guy who needs a lot of reassurance that I'm going on the right track. But there were two people from this church that spoke words of confirmation to me at just the right time, just when we were starting to plan this epic SovPat. The early Oxcart drivers were almost all Métis. And so I wanted a Métis to give his opinion of what we were doing. So one Sunday after church, I invited Randy Ranville and his wife Donna to come over for lunch. And Randy has been has worked with the Manitoba Métis Federation for many years.
Yeah.
So I wanted to, I thought that he would have some input. So I started telling him my story. And the more I talked about our Red River cart journey, the more excited he became. Until finally he said, yes, this is definitely from God. You have to do this journey, Terry. So that was very encouraging. And then Peter Todd also had something similar. His response was, I'm seeing God using this journey to touch every aspect of our community.
Amen.
When I shared with Terry Wall, he gave me a printed stack of prophecies about the city that he has collected over the years. And many of them speak of God using Winnipeg to reach the nations. There was one I liked a lot. It spoke of a fountain in Winnipeg, in the center of Winnipeg, a fountain of loaves of bread. It sprang up in Winnipeg and then became concentrated over the Canada-US border. It flowed down via rivers. It became a torrent through Minnesota, Iowa, and Illinois. The Mississippi and Missouri rivers carried the bread of God's presence to the Gulf of Mexico, strengthening and cleansing as it went. Beautiful. So one part of this epic SovPat that we haven't talked about yet this morning, Ken, is the second leg. So the Oxcart journey to St. Paul, Patty and I will take the cart. But then from St. Paul, we're going to take a paddle wheeler down the Mississippi to St. Louis. So that was actually, historically, that was the extension of the trade route from Winnipeg. But spiritually, it seems to me a part of this prophecy that was given. So yes, God loves Winnipeg like crazy, but God loves the nations like crazy.
That's right.
And it seems that all of us, according to this prophecy, all of us here in Winnipeg are part of that expression of God's love. So you asked if I was going in the right direction. Yeah.
Yes, you're definitely going in the
right
direction.
I think so.
That's right. And you're carrying God's love as you go. You're singing of God's love as you go. You know, the love of God that you speak of is mentioned in Psalm 48 using the word hesed, which is a Hebrew word that expresses God's faithful, never-ending, never-changing, steadfast love. That's what the word hesed means when the psalmist says, we have thought on your steadfast love, O God, in the midst of your temple. And then the next thing that's sung in that psalm is, as your name, O God, so your praise reaches to the ends of the earth, which is what you're talking about, these loaves of bread reaching to the ends of the river, the ends of the earth, to the nations. And our awareness of the love of God that you just mentioned is meant to result in God's fame spreading, right?
Yeah.
It's meant to result in his love being expressed everywhere, all over this world, until every nation has heard about it. So why shouldn't you get on that ox cart and travel the earth singing of God's love? I can just imagine, you know, this lonely prairie scene with nobody visible as you look in all directions, but there is this man in blue singing God's praise as an ox plods along the side of the road. That's going to be a beautiful scene. You know, Jesus himself said to the disciples, you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and in all Manitoba and to the end of the earth. Amen?
Yeah.
Yeah, and as we think of what Jesus did to express God's love for us, it should motivate us. It should motivate us to want to spread God's love, to tell others of his love, for his fame to cover the earth. So when Jesus died on the cross to receive upon himself the punishment that all of us deserve so that we could experience forgiveness, and because of his resurrection of God the Father raising Jesus from the dead, we could experience new life, the new life, resurrection life
of Christ in our own lives, that's something we want to share with others. And if you've never experienced it, if you're watching online and you've never seen that or experienced that love that Terry is speaking about spreading as he takes this Oxcart ride, we invite you to respond to his love this morning. And if you want to, just let us know. Click on that comment button on our website or come and see me or Terry after the service. We'd love for you to know Jesus this morning and to experience his love. That's something we want people in this city and this land and this world to know about. So Terry, as you ponder and pray about God's love for the people of Winnipeg and beyond, your prayers are going to reach the end of the Oxcart trail that you'll be following. And you leave this Tuesday.
Yep.
I checked the forecast. It's supposed to be sunny this Tuesday.
I've been praying for a nice day for departure. I know we're going to get rain along the way, but at least if we could leave in sunshine, that would be
great. Well, you've got people praying. We have prayer times at 7 in the morning for half an hour and 12:30 at noon every weekday. And because of our expansion project, we've been praying for the weather to be good weather. So you'll have people praying every day for good weather.
Good.
And we want to pray for you as you're on this trip, because it's incredibly exciting. Is there you texted me a verse from Psalm 84 this past week. Blessed are those whose strength is in you, whose hearts are set on pilgrimage. As they pass through the valley of Baca, they make it a place of springs. The autumn rains also cover it with pools. They go from strength to strength till each appears before God in Zion. Your heart is set on pilgrimage, Terry. And how can we pray for you and for Patty and for your ox, Zeke, as you depart this Tuesday?
An ox cart journey is pretty cool, but it takes a lot of energy and a lot of planning. And we've seen God's hand in all of that, taking down all the obstacles and making it possible. Plus, there's a lot of fun that he's put in along the way, like Lajimodi's box.
Yeah.
But I sure don't want an ox or a cart or a box to detract from what we want to do. Mm. Get us off our mission. And our mission is declaring the sovereignty of the Creator and his heart for people.
Yeah.
So please pray that the distractions and the problems we encounter, that they won't derail us.
Yeah.
You know, it's funny, we're on a prayer journey, and yet we're asking for prayer. But the beautiful things that God could well do on this trip or through this trip, it needs a team.
Yeah.
And yes, we rely on you praying completely. We have sensed enemy opposition. It often comes in the form of discouragement or feeling overwhelmed. So please pray for victory over the enemy. I said that the obstacles have all been removed. Well, that's not exactly true. There is a Red Sea south of Winnipeg that we want to travel through. So it needs to be parted. A couple days ago, Patty and I took a little drive down St. Mary's, which is actually the original route of the Red River Trail, just built up into a road. And we took it over the floodway and hadn't gone very far when it disappeared into water. So we need the Red Sea parted, the Red River parted. But he's done it before. And another thing that God has done before is the same trip, actually, with the Israelites. He made their shoes last the whole 40 years that they were tramping through the wilderness. And we need our Zeke's hooves, all eight of them.
Eight? He's got 8 feet?
Haven't you read Leviticus? Cloven-hoofed, choose its cud.
4 times 2.
But if anything would go wrong with these 8 hooves, that's the end of the trip. Yeah. We're pretty dependent on them, so... We, you know, please pray that all these little things, which are so vital for a trip like this, that God will just keep on
Are you like? Yeah. Are you planning on using bridges? Or are you gonna?
Yes, we are planning to use bridges. But I would like to. You're getting me off track here. We'd like to at least do one traditional fording, which might be as soon as the Red River, just south of Winnipeg. And we'd like to do one. If you guys know your history, the Métis Oxcart is actually maybe the first amphibious vehicle in the world. You can turn it from a land traveling vehicle into a boat. So our hope is to cross the Mississippi River that way. So we'll see if my courage still holds by the time we get there.
Wow. We do need to pray for Terry and Patty. I expect Patty will be watching from the shore. Wow. Yeah.
Yes, she definitely will be watching from the shore.
Like, I'm feeling a little worried for Zeke here. Like, he's going to be
no,
okay.
Zeke's fine. Zeke's fine. Don't let him know that you're worried about him. He takes every opportunity to pass a herd of cows and call for sympathy from them. So he doesn't need any more from humans.
Yeah. Oh, that's excellent.
I actually had one more prayer request.
Sure.
Okay. The biggest request of all, it's kind of goes along with the last verse that you read, which is we want God to shower pools of blessing as we go.
Yeah.
And that he would do his Winnipeg-changing, world-changing, life-changing stuff.
Amen.
Through this, yeah.
Yeah.
If you want to pray for us as we go, and I hope a lot of you do, and pick up a card, there's one card for the ox cart trip and one card for the paddle wheel trip. So pick it up, and I'm sure this interview has generated a lot of questions in your mind about how we're going to be doing stuff. There's an address on the back for Patty's Facebook page. And you can follow it on Facebook, and she writes stuff that would probably answer most of your questions, so you might have to dig through it, but they're there. So,
yeah, the name of the Facebook page is a sentence, by Oxcart Down the Red River Trail.
Yeah.
So if you do a search on Facebook for that,
yeah,
you can follow along. You can follow the journey all the way to the Mississippi,
yeah,
and to St. Paul. Well, this is incredible. Have you ever heard of such a thing? No, but you know what? This has been something the Lord has clearly led Terry and Patty in. Not something they're just... It's not like they're just not following their own thoughts here. The thoughts of God have led them. The heart of God has led them for a city and for nations. And so, why don't we pray? Could we pray for you now,
no,
Terry? And
of course.
Let's do that. What time is it? There we go. Let's pray for Terry, and then you can come on up and you can get prayer cards. Let's, if you want to, sort of as an expression of your participation in prayer, and if you're near Patty and Mary there, please just lay your hands on Patty and Mary there. Mary's not going with them, but she might join them for a kilometer or two. And let's pray for you guys. Father, thank you so much for your heart for people, the people of cities. Lord, you say you're going to establish a city one day, the city of God, because your heart is for where the people are and where people gather. Your heart is expressed in love. And I pray, Lord, that as you lead Terry and Patty along this Oxcart Trail, you'd lead them in their prayers. You'd put prayers on their hearts, and the prayers they pray would be answered. And Lord, as they, wherever that ox puts his hooves and wherever Terry and Patty put their feet as they walk and roll along this trail, Lord, your sovereignty would be expressed. Lord, the word of God says the Lord has established his throne in the heaven and his kingdom rules over all. You rule over every kilometer of this journey, and I pray you'd keep them safe. I pray that you'd watch over them and watch over their health, that in the midst of rain and in the midst of changing temperatures, you'd keep Terry healthy, you'd keep Patty healthy, and you'd keep that ox healthy, you'd keep his hooves healthy. And I pray, Father, that they would accomplish this goal because, Lord, you who have called them is faithful, and you will see them through all the way to St. Louis. Lord, we pray for your protection and for your anointing on them as they
go out on this adventure this Tuesday. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Yeah, bless you, man. Well, God bless you, and thank you for your patience this morning as we've taken a little extra time for this. Terry's going to be moving at about 15 kilometers a day, so we thought we'd kind of take our time this morning and move a little slower, take a little longer. All right, and if, as you go, you want to grab prayer cards, which I hope you do, please do so. And God bless you this week. Have a great week.